Good afternoon. Welcome to the Extension Hour right here on Lone Star Radio every Friday, 1 to 2. Yeah, what time is it? I'm so, like, confused sometimes. I don't know what day it is, but it is Friday. This Friday, and this is Extension Hour, and you will find us here every Friday. And then also you can listen to our shows on a podcast, so on SoundCloud, on YouTube. You can find that on irlonestar.com is one option, which also people can listen to through that. And also on our website, montgomerytx.tmu.edu, I think is what it is. You should check those.
They can just look up the Extension Hour, and then that'll be easier.
Oh, thanks.
So,
you know what? So, Dick, you can be our special guest here today.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was just trying to leave.
No, yeah. So sometimes he's just over there and he just looks at me like, "What are you talking about?" But today he's chiming in. Thanks, Dick. Glad to have you.
Thanks for having me.
And our other special guest today is Penny Fry. You want to say hi, Penny?
Hello, everyone.
So, Penny. Say it again.
I'll try that again. Hello, everyone.
Penny, she's hot money. Penny Fry. I'm going to do my announcements in just a minute, but introduce yourself. Tell us about you.
I'm here today to speak for car seat education and the program that we have here in Montgomery County that we've had for 9 or 10 years that many people still do not know about. So I'm here to talk about child passenger safety and how to keep your little ones safe and hopefully uninjured or not injured as greatly if you're in an accident.
Yep, definitely want to keep kids safe. So it's a really, really important topic that we want to talk about. We've got great resources for that. So, but before we do that, let me tell you about some of the things that are going on. We have tomorrow, actually, our Montgomery County Master Gardener Association is hosting an educational class. And they've been doing this kind of Saturday series. And on March 11th, they're actually doing 2 sessions. So not every Saturday is there 2 sessions. Sometimes it's just 1 in the morning. But on March 11th, they're going to do session 1 is best plants for the landscape. And then session 2 is about pest disease affecting flowers, shrubs, and trees. So the first session is at 9. The next one is at 1. They last approximately 2 hours. And I think that there's a $5 charge for those. And you can sign up by calling the Extension office, 936-539-7825. There's a voice menu system where you can ask to talk to a master gardener and find out more about that. So that is this Saturday, March 11th, because today is March 10th. And then the next Saturday, March 18th, is our annual plant sale, the master gardener's plant sale. So they will have all kinds of plants available to purchase, really good things. And the great thing about the plant sale that the master gardeners do is that you can also get information. I mean, you've got somebody to talk to. I mean, I guess you could go to any kind of local place and maybe have someone to talk to, maybe not. But all the master gardeners are right there on hand. They're volunteers. They're there to help. So they love doing what they do. Kind of like, so I'm looking at you, Penny, and you're like this amazing volunteer. And you remind me of them because they don't get paid for it. They just do it because they love it. So anyway, the plant sale, Saturday, March 18th. At 8 o'clock, they have like a little presentation about choosing and selecting plants. So it kind of gives you a good idea of what to do when you go out there to look. And then the sale actually starts at 9. They finish up by 12. But they have quite a selection of citrus, avocados, berries, vegetables, perennials, native plants, and much, much more. Some days I cannot talk.
And they're really busy there, too, aren't they?
Yes.
It's a crowded. I've been there. It was years ago because I tend to kill the plants that I really want to keep alive, even though I try really hard. But they know what they're doing, and they have, I mean, there's a lot there.
There is. A great variety and, like, some really good quality plants. And then you've got people to talk to. And lots of people know about it, so they come on out. So plenty of parking over in the Lone Star Convention Center parking lot. Walk across the street, grab yourself a wagon, and go load up on some plants. All right, so then also, we do 4-H and youth development. That's a big part of what we do in Extension. And upcoming with that, it's kind of contest season. So right now, there's lots of stock shows going on. Houston Livestock Show and Rodeo I think it's already started. So I'm going on Tuesday. I have to have to. so the, we're going to talk about this. Thing. Yeah, there, well, there's another event that we're going to talk about that's available, but I get kind of reassigned to this Houston Livestock Show and Rodeo, the Food Challenge. So I say have to, but it's really kind of fun
yeah,
to
that's
do.
That's why I was joking that you just have to. Oh, you poor thing.
Yeah. So it's cool because it's kind of like patterned after like Iron Chef for kids. And they work in teams of 3 to 5. They bring a tub of equipment to the site. And it's really interesting when they do this at the stock show because they do it in an arena. So it's not the most sanitary. but we don't get to taste the food. Which is good because it's in the arena and, you know, there's been animals there. So, but besides that, it's really awesome because so they bring their tub of equipment, they get a bag of groceries, they have 40 minutes to make something. They make it, they bring it to the judges and present it, and they do a little interview. They talk about the nutrition, the food safety that they would follow under normal circumstances, and how much it costs, and just, you know, why is nutrition important for your body and good health and all that stuff. So it's a really cool contest and then great project that leads up to doing that. Anyway, so we also have one for our district contest. So that is actually in May, and that's May 11th and 12th. And we call it Big Time in D9 because we're District 9. And I'm mentioning that too because we look for volunteers to help with that. So there's tons of contests that go on at that event. Public speaking contests, they do what we call educational presentations, which are used to be called method demonstrations, but it's also public speaking, but it usually uses some type of visual to also add to that. So we look for judges for that. We'll have a food challenge. We have quiz bowls. There's all kinds. There's 3 or 4 different quiz bowl, beef, swine, food, horse. So it's kind of a game show format where they get to buzz in and answer their questions, and it's a tournament kind of thing. Food show, fashion show, share the fun. It's kind of like a talent contest. So many activities, and we're lucky we get to host this in Montgomery County. So there's like 19 counties around in our district, and they all come to Montgomery County on May 11th and 12th, and we have a big contest. And so we rely heavily on our local volunteers to help with that. So if anyone's interested in that, we definitely want to have help. So let us know if you're available. And again, you can call our extension office, 936-539-7825. And I say that because we've got several phone numbers, but they all kind of get you to the same place. and then on top of that, we're really busy in our Family and Consumer Sciences department now too. So in addition to car seat checkup events that are coming up that we're going to spend a lot of time talking about, we have our Families Reading Every Day project. And so that's with our Head Starts here, our local Head Starts, and we call it FRED for short, Families Reading Every Day, FRED. And it's a 4-week project where we really focus on getting parents involved with reading with and to their children. And so that's going to kick off in the end of March, and then the project will happen in May. The project will happen in April, and then in May we do a big celebration. So we bring volunteers in to the Head Start sites. They read with the kids, and we give them little prizes and just really help them develop a love for reading and good stuff there, you know, literacy development, all those kinds of things. And then we also have our Walk Across Texas coming up April and May. So that's a big focus on physical activity. We encourage people to gather up a team of 8 to participate. It's really simple. It's like pretty much all online. We can provide lots of helpful information for people who want to do it. But the big thing is get your team and sign up. And then starting April 1st, you do physical activity. So walking is probably the main thing. And you know what? When you do car seat checkup events, give a sweat there. Yeah,
in the heat.
Yeah, that's some workout there. other types of physical activity too. Because for walking, you know, for some people that's the thing. For some people, not so much. So you can do other types of physical activity and then figure out how it equates to miles. And our goal is for a team of 8 to do 830 miles. So roughly the distance from Orange to El Paso. And so that's each person does about 10 miles a week. So not too bad. It's very doable. A couple miles a day will get you there. So the idea is that we're just getting people more physically active and really focusing on it. Focusing I'm making up new words.
I'm from Cut and Shoot. You're good. I understood you completely.
Yeah. So really focused on physical activity, and we have prizes. Everybody who participates gets an incentive card for discounts at local places. So really, really good stuff. So again, if you want to find out more about that, give us a call. Or you can go online, www.walkacrosstexas.tamu.edu. And that'll get you to the website that's kind of got everything you need on there. And you know what? This morning, I went to the Academy for Lifelong Learning in Montgomery and did a presentation on coloring. It was fun. We had crayons and coloring pencils, but it was coloring your stress away. And so I just mentioned that because a lot of people, you know, like, what all do you guys do? Because we actually do a lot in extension. So and we offer that wherever we're invited is kind of what we look for. So anyway, we had a really good time talking about stress, managing stress, and then coloring as a way to kind of relieve some stress. And so we get into coloring, and all of a sudden, fire drill. The fire alarm goes off. Neek, 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 neek. You know, here we are, just we're coloring, we're listening to nice music.
And then the alarm goes off.
Yes, and the fire drill, and then it doesn't stop. And we're like, what are we supposed to do? So we all head out to the hallway, have our ears covered, and then it ends, and we get to go back and finish.
Everything was okay.
Coloring. It was fine. But yeah, it did create a little bit of stress.
They just wanted you to feel like you were back in school.
That's
right.
You
were really coloring.
I know.
Get the full effect.
Yes. It was crazy. So speaking of school, one other thing that I like to mention is a presentation that we can do that's called Chef Plate. And I have this alter ego where I dress up. It's kind of like a cross between a radio clown and Rainbow Bright, something, I don't know. Anyway, lots of fun, energy. So we teach kids about nutrition by having Chef Plate make a My Plate pizza. So we use the parts of pizza to explain how it relates to My Plate, which is the Dietary Guidelines for Americans. It's kind of the icon to help people understand like what they should eat each day, which is really boring, right? But doing Chef Plate makes it really fun.
Easier for the kids to get involved with it.
Yeah, most definitely. So we just have a few minutes before we go to break. So let's talk, though, about the things that are coming up while we're talking about dates and activities and things. Just really quickly, what are the next checkup events that we have for car seats?
This next week, we have, it's Tuesday the 14th, I believe. Mm-hmm. I got it. Okay, the 14th, we're actually going to be at the Children's Museum in the Woodlands. We'll start checking seats at 10 a.m. that morning and should end a little afternoon. They tend to be very busy in the Woodlands.
Yeah.
So if anyone needs a free car seat check, education on how to properly restrain their children or child, they can come out then. And then April 8th, we're going to have a very big event in Montgomery County. We did it last year in September, and we checked more than 100 car seats in half a day.
Oh, wow.
It was the most proud I've ever been of our little team. It was amazing. So we're doing that on April 8th. The press release goes out on Monday. You should be seeing stuff about it, and we'll start taking appointments. April 8th is appointment required. You must have an appointment to be helped. And then on Tuesday at the Children's Museum, they can make an appointment at MoCo Kids, like from Montgomery County, mocokids.org, or they can just show up on Tuesday. But I'm sure we'll get into more details about that. So those are the next two events. We try to float around the county is what we try to do.
Right, right. And then so we do have car seats available for people who really need them. They're not free, but we ask for donations so that there's a little bit to offset that cost.
Yeah, it's kind of like a reduced cost.
Yeah.
It's not even, it doesn't really come close to what the car seat cost is, but it's a way to keep the program going because everyone's, including us, we don't have a ton of funding. So on Tuesday, if anyone needs a seat, it's $20 is what we request for the reduced cost, and they're brand new seats. We cannot give away a used seat. That's not good. That's right. Something we may cover in a little while, but don't buy one at a garage sale, or buy it and I'll buy it from you and get it off the street. But Tuesday, the car seat check itself, the education is free. We do accept donations if anyone feels so inclined, and it goes back into our program, but it's a free service that we provide. April 8th will be free. There will be no required reduced cost.
Okay.
So that's why I stress you must have an appointment.
Have to have an appointment, yes. Okay, so we're going to talk more about that. So maybe somebody's listening going, yeah, I know somebody who need, or I need to understand how to do a car seat, but, I can't go out those days. So we're going to take a little break here in just a minute. But then when we come back, we're going to talk about just some of the things to consider when looking at car seats and keeping your kids safe, because we definitely want to keep those safe. So stay tuned. We'll be back in just a bit.
Lone Star Community Radio is FM. That's right. Set your radio dials and your button presets to Conroe's FM 104.5 and 106.1, coming in June of 2016. To celebrate this edition and the addition of video versions of our talk and music shows on YouTube, cable TV, and our city TV, we are offering special sponsorships rates, which include free audio spots that are played throughout our broadcast. Interested? Check out our sponsor rates for shows just like the one you're listening to online at irlonestar.com/sponsor or call the station at 936-647-5747. Reaching the people of Montgomery County with Montgomery County's community radio station with Lone Star Community Radio.
To be back. Welcome to the Extension Hour on this lovely afternoon in downtown Conroe. You're listening to Lone Star Radio at 104.5 or 106.1. Don't forget you can also listen online at irlonestar.com. And we do record and podcast all the things. So if you're listening and maybe you just have a second and you only caught part of it and you wanted to hear more about whatever topic we're talking about, which today is a really important topic of keeping our kids safe, you can always go back to listen to those. And so different websites. Where is it at, Dick? What do you do?
Just look up the Extension Hour, or you can visit irlonestar.com/TEH.
For the Extension Hour. Uh-huh. All right. Thanks. I had to give you an opportunity to say something, because you're like our special, special guest today, even though this is like, you're home away from home, huh? All right. Thank you. All right. So we're talking about car seats, keeping kids safe. It's kind of amazing how confusing car seats can be. I mean, it's pretty simple, I guess, if it's one car, one seat, one child. But there's so many options out there. Trying to understand those can be really overwhelming.
Well, between the car seat manufacturers mm-hmm. and the vehicle manufacturers, they don't make it easy. they don't.
Not at all.
They really don't. To become certified, I'm a car seat nut, and now I'm a certified nut, and now I'm an instructor, so it's mm-hmm. like, watch out. But to become certified, our title is Child Passenger Safety Technician.
Technician, right.
And so to become certified, it's a 40-hour class. I'll never forget when I was first told I could become certified because I was a very pregnant mom in Montgomery County and was told I had to drive to Houston in July to get a car seat check. And I was like, you have lost your mind. Mm-hmm. But when they told me that I could become certified, I was like, okay, sure. What does it take? They're like, it's a 40-hour class. And I'm like, you've lost your ever-loving mind. Like, 40 hours? But even in the class, I mean, you've gone through it. You've gone through it. There's so much to it. And then we have to learn because there's overlapping seatbelts and there's new manufacturers can have a model of a car seat from a year ago that's different than it is now. So they make it very difficult.
Right. So before we get too far into that, tell us mm-hmm. a little bit how you got into it.
Kind of touched on it.
Yeah.
Well, I knew people, well, I don't know about people like me. I knew car seat people existed. Mm-hmm. Okay. My daughter will be 15 this year. When she was a year old, I had a car seat check at Memorial Hermann in the Woodlands. Mm-hmm. It was scheduled. This was years ago, and we don't do it this way now. We actually teach hands-on. We want the parents, popping the seatbelt and putting it back in after they clean up the Cheerios or whatever's happened. But I'll never forget, I think it was three or four technicians, because that's what we call ourselves, we're car seat techs. They put the car seat in the car, I learned how to put my daughter into the seat, but I really didn't learn how to put the seat into the vehicle.
Right.
So it sat in my Suburban for years. I never moved it because I was scared.
Yeah.
If it took that many certified people to do it,
how the hell can I figure it out?
Okay. Right. So that's not how we do things nowadays, and I'm not knocking the program. We've learned so much through the years. It's an amazing, amazing thing that we offer our community. But so flash forward a few years, and I'm pregnant with my second. Okay, I'm going to go get a car seat check. I need a car seat check. And you wouldn't believe how many people suddenly realize, oh, I'm due next month. I need a car seat check like right now. Mm-hmm. Or I'm due next week. So when I actually got in touch with someone locally, and they told me, oh, and they were Memorial Hermann again, not to tout, but I only had two children, and they were born there, even though I love all of our hospitals, but two nurses were on duty, currently certified child passenger safety technicians, and they would not look at my seat. They wouldn't help me. They wouldn't tell me if I've done anything right or wrong because of liability issues. Totally respect it. Get it now. As a very pregnant mother, was not a happy mama. So I found, was put into contact with Texas Children's, which is, we're SafeKids Greater Houston. That's who I'm a volunteer with. They're housed out of Texas Children's. And she was an amazing, she put up with me, a very, again, I keep saying, very pregnant mom in the summer. And that's when she told me about, you know, I told her, how big are we? I mean, how big is our county? Why don't we have this service for our families? And she was like, well, we can just, there's another class coming up. Did you want to become certified? I'm like, sure. What'll it take? She's like, oh, 5 days, 40 hours. I'm like, you've lost your ever-loving mind. Said that before. So flash forward 9-10 years now. And we have a team. We have Montgomery County Sheriff Department, the Sheriff's Office. We have deputies. I think we have 10 currently certified and active, which is really important. Montgomery County Hospital District. They're a very key part of our program. We have a few volunteers like me that are just nut jobs that are not tied to an organization, but I'm rare. So if anyone's listening and you're just a nutty car seat mom or dad, feel free to join on board. It doesn't take any kind of, you don't have to be in the medical field.
Right. A lot of people think that they have to have some kind of job that's related to it. And that's where a lot of technicians come from. I mean,
a lot of people are voluntold. We try to stay away from that. So you don't have to be a paramedic. You don't have to be a fireman, which we have no firemen on board right now, which I would love because that's like an old wives' tale in our county. Go to the fire station, and those guys may have the best intention. But to my knowledge, we don't have any currently certified technicians at any of our fire departments. We do have quite a few sheriff deputies that I mentioned, MCSO. And then Conroe PD, we had several technicians involved. But, you know, people change positions. They're promoted or, you know, change their shifts. Right. And so the team fluctuates from time to time. We have people like Amy. She is,
yay.
Bevan Myrna at the main Texas A&M AgriLife Extension office put me in contact with her years ago. And so she's a part of our team. I'm trying to think. We have a nurse at Conroe Regional Hospital. She's certified. But if anyone's interested in becoming certified, I will take you up. Like, I've had parents that have shown interest at an actual car seat check. Mm-hmm. Like, come out. Come mentor. Come see what it's about. Because we want you to know what you're getting into.
Sure.
Because it's not always fun. It's rewarding. Don't get
it
me wrong.
Good stuff, yeah.
It is. But, you know, playing in August in a car without air conditioning and on a blacktop parking lot can sometimes be a challenge. But, yes, it's – the team is – I don't want to forget anyone – the Citizens Academy at the Sheriff's Department has helped us with events before. Mm-hmm. They're as volunteers. It's a great team. Now we check seats. We were doing it at least twice a month. Well, now it's weekly at MCHD at the Montgomery County Hospital District. She offers checks every Wednesday.
It's Ashton, right?
Ashton.
She's awesome.
She's stuck with us now. It's been a couple of years since she joined us, and she is so stuck. But my goal for us, for our team, is to float around the county so that East County is, you know, assisted and they don't have to drive to Montgomery, or Montgomery doesn't have to drive to the Woodlands. Mm-hmm. And we also do the big events, like we mentioned before, like the Children's Museum in the Woodlands is on Tuesday, and then April 8th we'll be at the Sheriff's Department, their training academy. That's on a Saturday. It's a great service we provide, and so many people don't know we exist.
Right, right.
They don't know we're out there.
Or they think that it's, like, really... Oh, you can just check it, right? You can just, yeah.
Yeah, we had that last week. Yeah. We had a check actually in Montgomery at a preschool, and we were flooded with people to begin with. Mm-hmm. But they were, I have three seats in my car. I'm like, okay, well, come on up, fill out the paperwork, we'll get started. And they thought it would take 10 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes to mm-hmm. check all three seats. No, what's amazing about the program to me, and the thing that really gives me the goosebumps when I'm out there in the parking lots, is we teach the parents. We educate them how. But then we haven't, knock on wood, we haven't thrown anyone into labor if they're very pregnant. But we want the parents. I mean, we may not ever see these families again. So we want the caregiver, whether it be mom, dad, grandma, grandpa, we want them to be able to uninstall the seat and put it back in correctly. And that's what we do. So we teach you how to put your child into the car seat and do it correctly. And then we also teach you how to put that car seat into your car. And then we make certain that you can do it, because we may never get a chance to see them again.
Right. So it's all about empowering the parents to do it themselves. Because like what we mentioned before, it can be overwhelming. And, you know, and parents have the very best intentions. They want to keep their kids safe. But the information can be overwhelming. So just giving them those tools that they need to install those seats correctly is really important, because it is confusing. And so, you know, any kind of new thing that you learn is going to take a little bit longer than just a couple of minutes. I think the other great thing about it is that, you know, like you can shove a flyer at somebody and say, here's all the information that you need, but the hands-on, this is how you do it. And then I also think about, like, maybe going to the doctor's office. You know, sometimes they don't spend much time with you, and you're like, I want to keep myself healthy, but I don't know what to do. I don't even know what to ask. And sometimes they only spend just a few minutes with you. So the great thing about the car seat checks and the education is that it's going to be more than a few minutes, because you're going to leave with knowing what to do.
That's our entire goal. And it's wonderful. I've seen everything from parents give, you know, like a shout for joy. I've mm-hmm. seen tears on their faces because they were like, I can't do it. You know, this, you know, they'll come in and the seat keeps sliding on the leather and I can't make it tight enough, or I can't do this and I can't do that. And it's just impossible. Mm-hmm. And then we show them a few tricks that we've learned and we share it with them, and then they do it. And it's just to see that on their face, to know that we've passed it on to them and that they're going to be able to keep their child safe as possible. Mm-hmm. It is the most amazing thing. That it really is. And it doesn't matter. You have your manuals. I mean, how many manuals are online now? How many yeah. times have we accessed our phones to pull up a manual if we didn't have a car seat right. manual? But you can try all you want. I want to say in the 9 or 10 years I've been doing this, I think I've seen 2 seats installed completely correct.
Right.
Like, really. I mean, but between the child and the seat into the vehicle, the mistakes that are made, some are so common and some are twisted straps or a twisted yeah. seat belt. It can be so many different things.
Yeah. So we're probably going to take another break here in just a minute. And then when we come back, though, let's talk a little bit about, you know, what those little common mistakes and, you know, why are those things important? Because sometimes it is difficult to understand, you know, why does it matter where the chest clip is?
Or that it's a chest clip and not a belly clip.
Yes.
Yep. That's important.
So we're going to do that. But I wanted to just say one more time, you're listening to the Extension Hour. And every Friday, you may hear somebody different. Next Friday, you're going to hear from Michael Potter. He's our horticulture agent. So he is always full of good plant information. But we'll be back in just a minute. You're listening to Lone Star Radio, 104.5, 106.1, and IRLoneStar.com.
You are listening to the Extension Hour with Texas A&M AgriLife. Visit us online at montgomery.agrilife.org.
Did you know your favorite show on Lone Star Community Radio are on social media? Facebook, Twitter, Google+, Instagram, you name it, they're on it. Check out where they are online on irlonestar.com/shows and see which of your favorite hosts are online. Make sure to follow them and see what is in store for the next broadcast. Follow Lone Star Community Radio on Twitter at IRLoneStar or Facebook with facebook.com/IRLoneStar.
Yep, you are listening to the Extension Hour right here on Lone Star Internet Radio. So IRLoneStar.com, 104.5, live, not internet, live on 104.5 and 106.1. And we have Dick Schisler here. And so you've said something in every other segment, so you got to have to say something now because you started it.
Lone Star Community Radio.
Community Radio. I'm sorry. It's not internet anymore. It used to be. That was like habit. Is that all you have to say?
It was a joke.
Okay. I'm trying. I try my best. All right. So Lone Star Community Radio, and we are the Extension Hour, Texas A&M AgriLife Extension Service, and we are all about community serving community with education. And we used to call this segment, or whenever I'm on, it's like the health and wellness hour, because we're all about family health and wellness and keeping your kids safe. Child passenger safety just goes right along with that. I mean, we talk about, you know, health, and we think in terms of, you know, eating right and exercising and all those kinds of things. But healthy living also means being safe in everything that you do. So keeping your kids safe in the car is important. And so we were talking before the break, you know, parents have their best intentions of keeping their kids safe. And, you know, legally, you have to have somebody, you have to have a car seat. But even that gets kind of confusing because laws change and it's not like it was when we were kids or when our kids were little kids.
I remember riding in the back windshield. I remember riding in the floorboard
we
of my nanny's car. I remember my mom using her arm as an airbag. I remember all of this. And mom, if you're listening, hello. But things have changed. I mean, technology, people texting and driving. I joke with my officers all the time that if they would let me ticket people, like just let me ticket people for unrestrained children or the kids in the front seat with the airbags, like
just driving down the road.
Oh my goodness gracious alive.
Pull over. Let me tell you about your car seat. It is a little, it saddens me when I see a little kid, you know, sticking their head near the window and they're totally unrestrained because I just think, you know, that it maybe seems easier at the time. And I know that some parents, one of the things that they, you know, the kid, he just won't keep his seatbelt on. I can't keep him in the seat. You know, and it's just, it's easier just to let
Or my kid wants to face forward. That's what they told me at one. No, they're the child, you're the parent. You keep them the safest way possible at all times. Yeah, we get that a lot. My own children will tell me. Like, they respond now when they see someone, if we're driving somewhere. Mom, did you see that kid standing up in the back seat? I'm like, oh my gosh. it hurts because we don't know where the accident may happen.
Right.
And it tends to be in our comfort zone, not on those cross-country trips that, you know, we may take.
Right. Some of, like, most wrecks are within 5 miles of home or something like that. I don't know the exact statistic.
Yeah, I didn't pull that statistic for this, but I want to say it was 80-something percent happen within 10 or 15 miles from home. And, I mean, it's just a very large number because that's where we travel the most.
Mm-hmm.
And the most frequent, it's
and maybe not as alert as we might be when we're right. in a new, unfamiliar area.
Yeah, it's hard, and it's heartbreaking because we don't as I don't. How many people have you been in accidents, and how many were your fault? I mean, you can be as safe as you want to be, and you can be as defensive as you want to be, and you can't always prevent every accident. You just
right.
can't.
We call them accidents because we don't expect them to,
right.
to happen. I mean, I have heard theory that there's really no such thing as an accident. There's preventable things. When I went through child passenger safety training the first time, they were really adamant about there's no accidents. There's wrecks. People are in wrecks. But there are things that could have been, in most cases, very few are truly, purely accidents. But besides that, I mean, the whole idea is that you don't know that it's going to happen, so you don't know, you know, when is the right time to strap your child in correctly. And, you know,
now or it could be tomorrow. It could right. be when someone leaves our car seat check. Mm-hmm. It could be on the way to the – I mean, you just don't know when it's going to happen. And the statistics say that the number one preventable injury and death of our children – I mean, it's the biggest taker of our kids,
mm-hmm.
but the injuries could be lessened – and possible deaths prevented, accidents, the wrecks.
Right.
I mean, that's huge.
It is.
If we can lessen an injury, save a life. Like, I would rather have my child have a broken femur or something, you know, that's a bad injury than a death. Or maybe no injury at all. We've heard those wonderful stories where kids walk away. Or car seats are even ejected from cars. But because they were buckled in the car seat correctly, the kids are safe.
Yeah.
So we don't know. The wrecks, the accidents, they happen. And we don't know where it'll be. And it doesn't matter because I hear it I hear it all the time. Or I have family members who, I'm praying to, you know, the Lord's protecting my kids. Okay, well, he also gives us wonderful tools. And so let's use them. You know, let's be as smart as we can. Sure. And if you teach your children from the beginning, they don't question it. My 9-year-old, who's a big boy, still in a booster seat. My poor daughter finally got out of a booster seat, I think, when she was 11 or 12. My kids have no chance, but they were the safe. That was the safest way for them to ride.
Yeah.
I think one of the statistics was 73% of all injuries could be prevented. Like, it's
right. That's going back to the idea of there's really no accidents because there are things that could have been done to prevent it. So let's talk about some of the common mistakes. I mean, some of them are pretty minor, and, you know, maybe in a crash or a wreck, it doesn't cause as much problems. But there are just some basic things, and then we'll talk also about some really serious things that or it's important to make sure?
Some of the most common things that we see, we try to document how someone arrives, not to give you a grade or not to point fingers, but just because we need to know how, you know, how did the child arrive and what do we need to look for. We see lots of those chest clips that are supposed to be chest clips, not, instead of between their armpits, or we say tickle spots or whatever with the kids, the older kids, we see them down on their bellies. And that's, they're not supposed to be, they're a chest clip. So they need to be up there. The biggest thing I think I see with newborns, especially, and a lot of children, the five-point harness, I don't know for those of you that may not know, we call them five-point harnesses, and a lot of parents may not understand that lingo. But the five-point harness, I joke with older kids, especially boys, because we say race car drivers wear them. But they're the seat belts that go over their shoulders, so that's two, beside their hips, and then between their crotch. And very common, so common, is that those straps are too loose. The harnesses are too loose. I'll be showing my cut-and-shoot roots here in a second. But if you can fold over that strap, the harness, and if you can pinch, or pinch, as my roots say, if you can pinch that strap, then it's too loose. You want those children, you want your child secure. We're not talking stop them from breathing, because we have a lot of first-time moms with newborns that panic, don't hurt them. And I just remind them, remember the ultrasounds and remember how they were all curled up tight.
I like to say give them a nice little hug.
A little hug. Like don't hurt. Yeah. But if the thing is, especially for little kids, but even the older ones too, if the harness straps are too loose and your chest clip is on your belly, well then those harnesses in an accident can come off their shoulders and the child comes out of the car seat. So it doesn't matter how well you installed the car seat into the vehicle, if you didn't restrain your child properly, then what good have we done?
Sure. Well, and we like to say that the 5 points are the reason why those 5 points are important is those are the strongest parts of the body. So when you think about physiology, the shoulders are very strong. The hips, you know, if something's like around the belly, if the chest clips is all the way down the belly and you think about a kid buckling over, that's going to cause a lot of damage to the softest part of the body, you know, the belly that has no bone structure to hold them back. So
it could, and that chest clip is really a pre-crash. It's more for right before the accident happens. So it could move down in an accident, but it's more about if that is where it needs to be, then those harness straps are going to stay where they need to be in the actual accident.
It's kind of everything in place.
Everything where it needs to be, and the child stays in the car seat, which is our whole goal. We also see seat belts. A lot of parents don't even know, honestly, before my kids. I remember sitting in a seat, and if I leaned wrong or did something, well, my seatbelt would lock. Well, I didn't know what that was for. I had no idea. Well, a lot of parents will put their children in the car seats, put the car seat in the car first, and then the child in the car seat, but they don't. It's emergency locking, like it switches over, and we teach the parents this because every car is different, or most of them are different, but they'll put the car seat in and they're like, oh, I've got it as tight as I can, and it's still like, when I turn a corner it leans over. Well, they don't know to switch. If they have one of the switchable retractors, they don't know to pull it all the way out really, really slow until it switches into that locking mode. But those are the kind of things that pre-kids I didn't
you don't even think about.
Right. I didn't know that we could use that to restrain a car seat.
And it's pretty simple once you know this is what my kid needs in this car with this seat.
Yeah. Absolutely. But that's part of what I love that we do, is that we give those tips to you. Or if you have a husband and wife and two different vehicles, you know, bring both of them up. We don't charge for the service. So bring mom and dad's, or bring grandma if she babysits, or whoever it may be. And we also empower the parent, or the nanny, or the grandma, whoever the caregiver is, so that they can do it, you know, when they drive away.
And I think an interesting thing to also add here, too, is that it's not an education thing. I mean, we have some really well-educated, smart people that still kind of need a little bit of help on figuring out their car seats, because
it doesn't matter. Yeah. It doesn't matter your education level. It doesn't matter your schooling. I'm telling you, they don't make it easy on us. No, it does. And you can study all you want. You can try as hard as you can try. You can read your manual and you can still not install that car seat correctly or not put your child in correctly.
So the common things, the chest clip, the harness, and the tightness of the seat belt itself.
Or twisted seat belts, twisted straps. We see that a lot. Just unrestrained children. It's so sad. Or kids in the front seat. Kids should not be in the front seat. Like, 14 and under, let's put them in the back. Those airbags come out really fast. They're safest in the back seat. What are some other things in the vehicle? We try to also talk about.
Yeah. Flying projectiles.
Yeah, my husband used to put, like, tools in the back of the Suburban, and I'm like, oh, my gosh, if we are, like, if we hit something, that tool's going to come flying. Yeah. So we talk about in and around vehicle safety. We try to talk about don't leave your kid in the car, even to run into the store. I mean, we've seen those stories about the cars, you know, disappearing with the kids in them, or heat. I mean, we're in Southeast Texas, so that's another issue. So we try to, we just touch on those kind of things. But the biggest thing is the car seat and teaching them how to do it. A lot of people don't know if they're a rear-facing kid or child, then the straps, those harness straps that we talked about, should be at or below their shoulders. Mm-hmm. And if they're forward-facing, they should be at or above. That's very common. I mean, how many people read the manual to figure that part out?
And sometimes it's hard to remember. It's like, I said, which horse is it supposed to be? and then the other thing I think that's difficult is when to move your child to the next seat, or which seat is right for them. So we're going to have to take another break. But when we come back, we'll talk about that. We're just going to go through each one of the ages and stages and kind of come help people understand what's the best way to do that. So you are listening to Lone Star Community Radio. This is the Extension Hour. I'm Amy Ressler. We'll be back in just a bit.
We're starting to film our talk shows and putting them on YouTube. Your favorite Lone Star Community Radio show can be seen on YouTube under our Lone Star Community Radio channel and on City of Conroe's Our City TV channel on Suddenlink Channel 12. Make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel to see the most recently released videos and find more information online at irlonestar.com/TV.
Lovely Friday afternoon on the Extension Hour, and that was just me. The little PSA that just ran about our mobile cooking school, which is a whole other topic of things we do, but among the wonderful things that we do, helping people, helping families, helping Texans make their lives better is child passenger safety and making sure that our kids are safe. And so we've been talking with Penny Fry, and she's been telling us her wealth of knowledge. So you're like, they call you one of those psycho mamas because you're like, you don't get paid. You do all of this stuff and you don't get paid for what you do. That's one of those amazing things, I think, about you.
I'm just a completely nutty volunteer. I'm very blessed to be self-employed and I work from home. So sometimes it is hard to juggle sometimes. But yes, many of our volunteers, they may not always get paid, but our deputies with the Sheriff's Department. Well, the Sheriff's Department supports us because they're paying them for their time most times, or the hospital district. But yes, I am a true volunteer. I'm that passionate. I'll never forget when I got into this years ago, my sister-in-law told me, why are you doing this? Your kids are going to be out of car seats soon. Mm-hmm. I'm just like, but I'm still passionate about it, even if they're not in car seats. I'm definitely a volunteer, but I love it. And I'm blessed to do what I do with our community, with all these great volunteers too.
Well, I think that's one of the things I admire most about you. I mean, I really do think that it's awesome. And then the way you coordinate all of the events and even those huge ones with 150 or whatever, I mean, you just make it happen. And there's no telling how many lives you have saved. I mean, put it down to that. You really, I would say, thousands of lives.
I love it. And again, one of my favorite part of this is the parents. We are teaching the parents and the grandmas and the aunts and uncles, whoever this caregiver is, they have the power to go on and do it the next time and the next week. And we've seen some children grow up, and we don't mind that at all. Again, our seat checks are free. Come back and see us. It's amazing.
Yeah. So speaking of growing up, so during the break, we were talking about one of those things that you say about, parents like kind of think that it's a rite of passage, or their kid is really growing up if they're going to the next seat.
They're almost proud of it.
Yeah.
They're almost proud when they go from a rear-facing seat to a forward-facing seat. Well, I want everyone to keep in mind that when our child, first of all, we want to be rear-facing as long as possible. We're the last developed country to really push for this. What's great about Texas right now, the way our law stands, is we're a proper use state, which I'm not an officer. They will not let me become one. Although I haven't applied, so that's not a threat, guys. But if our car seats tell us that they have to be, you know, people try to put two-year-olds in booster seats, please don't. That's not okay. So if it says that they have to be 2 years old before they can face them forward, then we'll follow that. And we're getting to that point. But we want your little one to ride the safest possible. That's the bottom line. So rear facing as long as possible, even if their legs are crisscross applesauce. That's what we hear a lot. And a lot of car seat manufacturers are giving them more leg room, but a lot of kids, they'll turn forward and then cross their legs anyway, so let's keep them rear. But many parents believe that when they turn them forward, especially if they've told their mom and dad they want to see out, well, it's, again, I could argue that point all day. Whenever you go to that next step in car seat safety, if you think they're moving up, the safety is actually decreasing. So when you switch your child from a rear-facing seat, and they're in the five-point harness that we talked about, and then they're forward-facing, well, they're not as safe as they were rear-facing. And then when you go from a five-point harness forward-facing into a booster seat, well, then you've just taken another step down. Your child may be older, but if they're not mature enough to handle an adult seat belt, then they could suffer injuries that they don't need, you know, right, that are unnecessary. So that's just something to keep in mind. Yes, our kids grow up, and they grow up too fast, but let's not push it any faster than needed.
Okay, so let's talk about infants, rear-facing car seats. So age one or proper use, and there's actually legislation maybe being...
I'm not a big fan of age one. That is a minimum, and I tease people all the time. I mean, you can have an alcoholic beverage, and as long as you're not tipsy, you know what I mean? Like, don't do that. So don't... You want to keep your kid the safest that you can. The minimum, and from the AAP, the American Association of Pediatrics, they've always said 1 year and 20 pounds, but as long as the seat will allow. Well, right, no one ever listened to that,
as long as
the seat will allow. So we want to stay rear-facing as long as we can, at least 2 years old, or if they hit the height or weight limit of the seat that they're in. And most people don't know that you can go from an infant-only seat, the one that has the click and base, then you go to a convertible. And those convertibles tend to have a higher weight or close to the same as your infant-only seat, and then you turn them forward, and some of those forward-facing seats can go up to 50 or 65 pounds harnessed, and then you move them to a booster.
Right, and then the boosters, they have to be at least 4 years or 40
minimum,
yeah, and then from the booster to...
An adult seatbelt.
Yeah.
So the biggest thing about the booster is you don't want them out of that booster seat yet, and there's some boosters that are really great that don't look like booster seats. They don't look like car seats. My son has one called an Incognito. We don't promote one brand over the other, but it doesn't have arms on it. It helps make the seatbelt fit him correctly. So you don't want if they're sitting in a booster, they need to make sure that the seatbelt stays on across their shoulder, not up on their neck, not under their armpit, not behind their head, and that the belt going across their tummy is not across their tummy. It's actually lower, and it's down across their hips.
Right, those strong points.
The strong points where if they're in an accident. So that's really important. You don't move your child out of a booster. The law in Texas is 8 years old or 4'9". Mm-hmm. Well,
most 8 year olds are not 4'9".
Yeah, it's an or. Mm-hmm. But I can tell you, my 9 year old still doesn't. Now, in one of our vehicles, he doesn't need a booster seat because that seatbelt fits him correctly. Mm-hmm. And in one, he uses a booster. So it just depends on the child. But you want to make sure if you can do something to keep them safe, then that's what you really. Let's do that, and let us educate you. Let us for free. And again, we don't laugh, and we don't point, and we don't take pictures and do anything crazy.
We don't embarrass.
We don't judge. We'd rather you come see us and let us help you than not.
Sure. So that's people are listening. Like, when you're talking about all this education, when can I go get my car seat checked?
When can you go? Okay. Well, this Tuesday, if you're listening right now, this Tuesday, March 14th, we'll be at the Children's Museum in the Woodlands. The Woodlands Township has asked us to come out, and we will be there starting at 10 a.m. I think it's from 10 to noon or 10, yeah, 10 to noon. And then Monday there will be a press release if everyone wants to keep a lookout. We're doing a very big event April 8th at the Montgomery County Sheriff's Department, their training academy. We checked over 100 seats last year in half a day. It was an amazing day.
Wow.
So we're doing that huge event April 8th. It'll be appointment only, appointment required for April 8th. And then I can give you a telephone number for the car seat program. And then we also have, you can schedule online at MOCO for Montgomery County, mocokids.org. You can also go to safekidsgreaterhouston.org. And they have a calendar and they have other locations because we're part of a great coalition where the Harris County Sheriff's Department, Friendswood, the partners in Houston, it's a very long list with a little type on the flyer. But you can look at events that go on around the Houston area because you may be in the Woodlands or you may be somewhere else. And we also have information for Huntsville and other places that do what we do. It's a nationwide certification. We can actually go anywhere. Care to go to the beach and teach a class? Would you like to, Amy?
Yeah.
Let's go to Puerto Rico. The number you can call too for appointments is 832-919-7233, and that's for our local coalition.
And then you can also call us at the Extension office, 936-539-7825, or you can check us out on Facebook, Healthy Living in Montgomery County. Hey, Dick, you want to say anything else before we go? Because you said you're shaking. No, no, he's saying wrap it up. Stop talking. All right, Penny, thank you so much for being here today.
Thanks for checking out this recording from Lone Star Community Radio. Lone Star Community Radio is Montgomery County's community radio station and broadcasted live from Conroe, Texas on IRLoneStar.com and Conroe's FM 104.5, 106.1. Interested in sponsoring this show, being a guest, hosting your own show, then please visit us online at IRLoneStar.com and check out the Contact Us page. We want to say thank you to our studio supporters, our traffic sponsor, Conroe Americana Music Festival at conroeamericanamusicfestival.com. For more information about the show, please check out the information below in the description.